Blog Talk Radio.
Counter Radio Network presents the Roundtable Report, a discussion of today's issues. So the kid gloves are off as we listen to real answers from real people. Come and join us on the Roundtable Report.
And good evening, John Jeffers here at the Contra Radio Network. The Roundtable Report for July 5, 2017. Tonight's the Roundtable Report, in case you new listeners don't know what that is. What that is, the Roundtable Report, is when you, the listeners, get to drive the conversation. Because the truth is this. I got nothing for tonight. So I'm relying on you listeners what you want to talk about. Announcement, though. I have an announcement. The announcement is this. August 21st. Which is a Monday, I believe. I'll probably be getting down there maybe a day earlier on the 20th. I'll be down at Terry Kaz's farm in Lebanon, Missouri. According to Terry, I believe Terry is billing this as beer, barbecue, and bullets. I'm not sure if the beer and bullets really go together, but anyways, I'll be heading down to Terry's farm. I'll be doing some, Cyber Patriot is in tonight. Welcome. He's on the video feed on the CRN like page. If you want to join us there, you can do that. For those of you that'd rather watch than listen. But anyways, we're going down to Terry Kaz. I'll be going down to Terry Kaz's farm on the 21st. Those of you that want to join us, more than welcome to. Talking to Terry last night. He's building a shooting range. And he said, bring your weapons. It's okay. So I told him I'd be bringing both my SIG 229s, 40 calibers, as well as my Hatson semi-automatic shotgun. So I'll be bringing those down. But if you want to join us, get a hold of me, ContraRadioLive.com. I'll give you the information, give you Terry's address, how to get there. Lebanon, Missouri is right off I-44, so it gives you an idea. Now, some of you, like Rob in Indiana, had the idea, hey, let's get a bunch of them together and let's all meet up. We'll be at Terry's place. Like I said, beer, barbecue, and bullets, August 21st. So if you got some vacation time or you want to take an extra long weekend, meet us down there. We might even do a show from there. I'm thinking that might be cool. But it's up to you. Like I said, get a hold of me at ContraRadioLive.com. That's my email. Cyber Patriot, he wants to talk about the epic imminent fall of Hobby Lobby. By all means, if you wish to do that, go ahead. Our number is 516-453-9389. Again, for those who didn't catch it, get your pencil and paper. I'll give you a second or two to get it. All right. Number again is 516-453-9389. Give us a call if you want to opine. Talk about, you know what, we'll talk about what your listeners want to talk about. That should be interesting. Absolutely. Okay, and let's see. No, Cyber Patriot, I haven't seen that. He says they're buying looted antiquities from Iraq. I would imagine that's what he wanted to say. But he says, if you want to join the Cyber Patriot, he is on the Facebook Live. That's our CRN like page where we are there now. And the chat room is open. Nothing going on there. I see that the United States has warned North Korea that, well, bottom line is this. They're ready to go to war. They have absolutely had it with the North Korean launch. All they got to do, the only missing piece of the puzzle for the D-pricks are the ability to build a nose cone to withstand the heat of reentry for the warhead. That's the only missing piece of the puzzle. If they get that missile they launched yesterday, can reach Alaska and potentially even Seattle. I'm putting it out there, folks. You decide whether it's worth talking about, what you want to say, what you want to do. That's fine. I've got no problem with that. For you people on the left, especially Antifa, are you lefties out there who think that you're going to start a civil war? You know, I got something I want to remind you clowns. All your favorite Hollywood lefties who are screaming about resist Trump, resistance, fight to the end, we're going to fight street battles. Hey, goofballs, if you think your favorite Kardashian is going to be standing next to you on the skirmish line, got news for you, fools. You're the useful idiots that Lenin talked about. All these Hollywood lefties who are screaming about resist Trump and go fight in the streets and, you know, resist, all the other crap. And that goes for Hillary Clinton and the rest of her clown group. What an asshat. Anyways, if you think they're going to be the ones doing the fighting right alongside you, they're not. They're not. You know, we see how Antifa acts, and then when they get their, you know, they get some patriots there, who decide, you know what, we're not putting up with it anymore. And they start wailing and beating the hell out of them. Guess what? They fall apart and fall back and scream and whatever. You know, who cares? We've seen the show before. We know how it ends. We win. Period. But like I said, if you think you're going to sit there and have your favorite, you know, Hollywood celebrity standing next to you on the skirmish line, I've got news for you, Jack. Ain't happening. They won't be there. Guaranteed. I thought I'd put it out there. I've been wanting to say that since last night. I was thinking about it. I thought, what can I say about these idiots? Okay, here's one. You know, you got that idiot Rob Reiner screaming about, you know, go to the streets and fight. Do you think that fat ass is going to be sitting on the skirmish line with you? I doubt it. He won't be within 200 miles of it. Guaranteed. But he'll sit there and he'll throw fuel on the fire going, rah, rah, rah. Guess what? He's the guy, after he, you know, gets everybody wound up and gets out there in the street, and somebody either seriously gets injured or hurt, he's the one who goes, oh, not me. I didn't say anything. I didn't do anything. No, screw you. You did. Here, this is for you, Reiner. Idiot. Can't stand it. Okay. I see Chuck is in the chat room. He should call in. Because, you know, he missed the last time we talked to him. He was defending the shooter or something. I don't know. Here he is. Hello, my friend. I'm glad you're here tonight.
Yeah, I have no idea what you're talking about.
The last episode that you were on, it sounded like you were defending the shooter at the Republican baseball game.
Was it me?
Okay.
No idea. No clue.
All right. Well, you know, you haven't been here for a couple weeks. You've missed a couple shows. What would you like to opine upon? Because I like to make sure you're... Oh, do you want to give a status report on the 11th APG? Do you have anything to share?
I got one person who's an EMT right now, but so far that's all I've been able to muster. I'm still in the middle of trying to gather more locally.
Okay. Putting it out there.
Yeah, an EMT is a good start, though, so I figure that's not really bad because that's skill set right there, so it's like a twofer.
It never hurts. It does not hurt. Mm-hmm. Having medical personnel in your prepper group is damn near golden. If it's not golden, it's platinum. It's really that good. It's really that important. So that's good stuff.
So I'm going to have to go to a regular meeting place and see if I can get a hold of BB there and see if he's still game for it. I'll get back to you on that. It's probably going to be an offline visitation.
What about Kenny? Did you get a hold of him?
Yeah, but he's got his own group going on. I'm not exactly sure if he's available to join the 11 APG. But,
No. He was
definitely, I would say that...
He was... He wanted to be affiliated with the 11th APG and use his group as a mutual assistance group. That was his thing. So, Yeah.
No, okay. Yeah, yeah, we didn't go into that fine of a detail, but I'll have to reach out to him to follow up. He sent me a message asking me about what did I think about the information he gave me so far. Because of Thanksgiving and all that, or not Thanksgiving, freaking 4th of July. See? Damn. Because of 4th of July, I just haven't been able to look at it yet. It's been really busy, so hopefully I'll get a chance to look at it before the end of the week, and then I'll follow up with him later.
Okay. When you talk to him, find out when the march on Richmond is. He likes to do a 5-mile there and 5-mile back walk. With a
backpack.
Right. Remember that? Okay.
Yeah, I heard about that.
Yes. That's okay. It's good exercise, if nothing
else. Did you do that too with him? Did you do that yet?
No, I'm going to do it this year. I got my dog. He's got his vest, which carries first aid kit, a bottle of water for him, and his collapsible water bowl. So, yeah, he's all set to roll.
I get it. So using your dog as a pack mule. That's a good idea. I should find a dog. Just joking.
Well, you know, he's not that big, so he can't carry a lot, but he carries a first aid kit and his water and his bowl. I've been taking him for walks every day, so he's built up. He's good. And I don't want it too heavy because I don't want to destroy his shoulders or anything like that. But, you know, it's got some.
Yeah, I hear you.
But he likes it, you know. So when I put that on him, he knows it's time for walk time, and he gets excited. But that and that's another reason why you should have a good sized dog. My dog is a Belgian Malinois. He weighs about 80 pounds. Brian Kiesler has one. He has a Belgian Malinois, and they're intelligent animals. They're relatively easy to train.
Yes, they are.
But the thing of it is, when you get them as puppies, you're going to have to be about 3 steps ahead of them all the time because they're always looking for something to do. As they get older and mature, they have a tendency to, gear it down a little bit. So now he understands a lot of different things. But they're all,
You totally missed what I said. I said, yeah, they're smart, and they also taste like chicken, but I wouldn't know. I never had dog before, so.
Yeah.
I'll stay away from your dog.
You might be a dog eater. I don't know. I don't know. I never thought about asking you about it, but if you want to bring it up and talk about.
No, I never did it before, so. The most exotic that I had was probably alligator. That's about it.
I've had alligator. So. It's pretty good.
Yeah. So let's check out the headlines here. This pattern is repeating itself over and over and over again.
Which one is that?
To infinity. Well, basically, Trump sends out a tweet. Takes him only a couple minutes to do so, right? He sends out a tweet. And next thing you know, CNN and MSNBC and all the other news media, they scrutinize the crap out of that freaking tweet.
What else are they going to do? What else can they do?
I don't know. Report the news?
No. No, because reporting the news requires journalistic ethics, which they totally lack. And if they did have news in front of them, they wouldn't know what to do with it anyways. So,
Right.
I mean, so what else are they going to do? The thing of it is this. Like I said, Trump spends 30 seconds on a tweet, and the media falls over themselves for the next 4 or 5 days. Meanwhile, while they're analyzing his every tweet, grammar, punctuation, meaning, hidden meanings, he's passing executive orders, getting stuff done. What's that? Cyber Patriot says, Tillerson says, Secretary Tillerson, parties must work through a political process to achieve a settlement that charts a way forward for the Syrian people. Really? There is no settlement or political process that will satisfy anyone in Islam, the Gulf states, etc. That's from Cyber Patriot. You know what? He might be right. And what was it? Brandon says, watch Stephen Molyneux's video about it. Brandon, give me a link and put it on there, pal.
So apparently over the 4th of July weekend, Chicago had 100 people that were shot out of the 115 actually were fatalities. So I think... I think it's clear to say that gun control thing that they have going on there isn't quite working. And you know what, Chicago, if you want to be on the road to resolving the issue, it's not guns. You have to know what the problem is, and you have to admit it. You have to say it. You have to have the freaking cojones, the anchors, to actually say it. You don't have a gun problem. You have a violent, armed gangster problem. Look, as soon as you acknowledge that, then I would say you're more than a quarter of the way there to finding a solution. But until then, you're going to be lost, and you won't find a solution. You won't be coming close to finding a solution ever until you call the problem for what it is. And it's not a gun problem. So that's my editorial.
Yes. Gun control does not work. It has never worked. The only place it works is in you're right.
Because I can guarantee you not one of those gangsters have a firearm and they own it legally.
Oh, no.
So,
well, they can't.
Yeah.
But the bottom line is this. They have an illegal gun problem. It's not legal gun owners. They're not the issue. If there were, they would know it. But the bottom line is this. Gun control does not work. It has never worked in this country, and it will never work. What we find every time is when you take guns, the option, because it's not mandatory, option to carry, conceal a weapon, a firearm, if you will, there's always the chance that nothing's going to happen. But you take it away, you take that option away from people, now the wolves are free to feed on the sheep without fear of retribution or retaliation. Case in point is the gun-free zones. Yay! No.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm pretty sure. Yeah, there was an incident that happened about a week ago. A doctor, a disgruntled doctor, actually went to the hospital.
Yeah, what was that about? Did they ever find out what that was about? Have they got a motive for that? I know. It's the NRA.
This doctor was dismissed, so I think that's what it was.
You know, when I heard the story, and I want to Channel 32, the Fox station here in Chicago, said, oh, he had an assault weapon. No, he did not. He had a semi-automatic rifle. Once again, the media has no clue what the hell they're talking about. They have no idea what an assault weapon is. Somebody made up the term. Somebody says, oh, yeah, it's an assault weapon, yeah. So, you know, screw them. What does Cyber Patriot say? He says, U.S. officials tells us the U.S. watched the North Koreans prepare for this launch in advance. They saw the missile being fueled with liquid fuel. Wonder how that went down since it was on a mobile launcher. I don't know.
You're talking about the ICBM launch that was actually successful already?
Yes. I got to tell you, I've been very upset that the Trump administration has cut me out of the loop on a lot of these intel decisions they're making. But, you know, they haven't come back to me and asked me, you know, what I think about it. They're just acting on their own. I wish they would, you know. Granted, well, I think the D-pricks are a bunch of maniacs, and we will be in a shooting contest over there before too long. We have other fish to fry here in the United States. Homeland, for example. Antifa. Every time those clowns show up, people should just start beating their ass right off the bat. Just save yourself time. Save yourself the effort. When they sit there, they get home. You know, they get there from mom's basement using mommy's car, and they're waving their flags. Go out there and just start punching. Just start punching them in the head. Now.
I think they have a valid point regarding the whole North Korea situation. Trump should say something. His administration should say something. Totally nothing at all. Maybe from a few representatives of the Pentagon, but that's basically about it. And from the Pentagon, it's more about alarm. It's more about warning than it is about action. If you ask me, you know, if you want to balance out the scales over in the Asian Pacific theater, time to arm Japan with nukes and time to arm South Korea with nukes as well. China won't like that, but as far as I'm concerned, the hell with China. let's make sure that both sides have mutually assured destruction. And then they'll think twice about shooting off their nukes first. That's what I think.
I don't think Japan, through their own constitution, allows nuclear weapons, for them to have nuclear weapons. I know that the...
Well, their own constitution didn't allow them to have a deployable fighting force and a naval fleet to go elsewhere in other theaters as well. So that part of the constitution pretty much, that ship sailed from the harbor already.
Well,
so,
yeah,
I think it's time for negotiating additional amendments to their constitution.
Well, I believe they got nuclear weapons stored at, I believe, is it Yokohama. And I don't know if they have anything at Misawa Air Base. I don't think they got weapons stored there. They might have nuclear weapon storage at Yokohama, I believe. Okinawa, I believe, may have a weapons depot there. I don't know. But again, like I said, the Trump administration has cut me out of the loop. I don't know how they could do that. But that's okay.
And yeah, and they did so to their detriment. Shame on them.
Oh yeah, I hear you. I'm very disgusted.
But I think, but from what I understand, in the country of Japan, they're freaking scared. They're.
Well, they've been drilling.
Look at a country who's going super prepping. Japan is going super prepping.
Oh yeah, they've been running drills already, evac drills and all that. Here. Let's get down to brass tacks. Is it really what's the point of nuking North Korea? There's not a lot there. They may hit Pyongyang and maybe a couple other places, but for the most part, the civilians are still starving. You know, look, I'm not saying the United States won't retaliate. They will. But how much?
What North Korea represents now is the same threat Japan represented when the United States Navy finally reached Okinawa. Okay, they still have a large fighting force, and they knew that sending, trying to occupy that country is going to cost a lot in terms of men and resources, in terms of lives. So for them, back then, for us, the two atomic bombs were pretty much the deciding factor. You're not looking at a situation any different in North Korea. They have a very large army. So if we try to go in there with men as well, then there's going to be lots of fatalities. So,
there will be.
And if we're talking about a small country with a very small global, let's say, area of real estate, if you will.
Exactly.
One nuke should be more than enough to
China will never allow.
Take them out of the picture.
China will never allow a nuclear power or a Western-aligned nation to be on their border. They won't allow it.
Well, even
but China, but that means that
China.
But China needs to step up
on high alert right now, and so is Russia. They're amassing military at the northern borders, respectively.
So let me ask you this: if China crosses the border, you can damn well bet the Russians are going to. You know, I don't. They're both on the border. Are you kidding me? And Cyber Patriot says, if you want to stop the nuclear capability, then you need to take it out early. Well, they've had many years to dig holes in the sides of mountains and store the crap there. Trying to get to it with a nuke. You know, it'd be kind of like, a Cheyenne Mountain type thing, I'm sure. I don't know if the technology is there for the deep pricks, but who knows.
How about a couple of fuel air bombs? Go conventional.
Oh, you know what? Those are nasty. Nasty, nasty. And I like them. It's the closest thing you're going to get to nuclear destruction without actually having to pop a nuke.
Right.
You know, they'd use...
And all you got to do is target one of their facilities.
Well, the FAE is going to suck all the oxygen around the air. And it literally suffocates any people that are around. So tonight I'm drinking.
Granted, there's still going to be some casualties, collateral damage, if you will. With the fuel air bomb, probably significantly a lot less than using a nuke. So I don't know.
Yep.
It's Right now, North Korea seems to be a more, I don't know, between North Korea and Iran, they're both viable threats, except that Iran, they have a missile that can go Mach 3 or Mach 5 or something like that, and I have no idea if it's nuclear capable or intercontinental capable. But of the two, the demonstration by North Korea pretty much confirms that, yeah, they have an ICBM, and it is now capable of reaching Alaska.
All right, well.
And if they improve it even more, maybe California and further in, who knows? Hawaii, definitely.
Okay. All right. Let me think.
Let's get some American nukes to South Korea and Japan. Let's balance the scales out. There you go.
All right.
Problem solved.
If you joined us late, I will repeat, the week of August 21st, I'll be down at Terry Kaz's farm for what Terry is billing as a beer, barbecue, and bullets for all CRN listeners. So if you want to meet down there, I'll be down there for, I think, August 21st. That's the day of the big solar eclipse. And I'll probably be down there for 2 or 3 days before heading out again. But I think Terry's building a shooting range on his farm. So if you want to join us, you can. I'm going to bring both my SIG 229s, the 40 calibers, and my Hatson semi-automatic shotgun. So if you want to meet us there, you can.
Where?
At Terry Kaz's farm in Lebanon, Missouri. Get a hold of me at contraradio@live.com, and I'll give you the details. Not there's a lot of details to give, but like, Terry's address, that kind of thing. So,
you got a date?
August 21st. I'll probably go down there on the 21st. I'll be down there probably the evening of the 21st, August. So if you want to make it like a long weekend and hang on down there, you could be good. Brandon says he wants, should I bring my Mini 30 and trying to sell? Why not, Brandon? Why not? I don't see why you couldn't. You know.
August 21st.
August 21st. That's next month. That's about what, 6 weeks away? 7 weeks?
Yeah.
So, you know, if you wanted to, you could. Rob in Indiana, this was his idea for CRN listeners to get together. And I'm thinking, you know, it's not a bad idea. Okay. So I figured do Terry's farm 1 year. We'll go somewhere else the next year. You know, maybe head on down to Texas. Okay.
I'm looking at that picture that you put on your page from Red Flag News 9 hours ago.
All right.
Of a whole bunch of North Korean military personnel with supposedly dirty nuke bomb packed in front of, in front of them, and they're marching with it.
Send that out. So, but if you want to join us, if you're listening on through Blog Talk Radio, or you want to watch the show, you can. We're on the CRN like page doing a live video feed right now. So, yes. What else do you want to talk about, sir? What else is on your mind? You've been out for 2 weeks.
On my mind?
You've been out for 2 weeks.
No, I wasn't out for 2 weeks. I was out for 2 days. I missed the one on Sunday and the one on previous Wednesday. That was it. So maybe 1 week.
You're killing me, man.
No, you know.
You're killing me.
Okay. I just want to say that I miss John Jeffers immensely.
Oh, you get a gold. All right.
I couldn't get him out of
No, okay. You are sick.
I couldn't get him out of my mind as I was waiting. Never mind. I'll stop right now.
I don't even know what to say. I don't. You're killing me, man.
So Terry is having. So Terry is.
Beer.
Or is it Brian.
Beer knows Terry.
Brian's having.
Brian.
Oh, it's Terry.
Brian might be up. I mean, Brian might come up for that. Brian's in the in western New Mexico.
Well, what do you say, Brian? You want to join me and John over at Terry's place for a little bit of firearm hootenanny?
We should all. all the listeners who could go should, you know, take a long weekend. You know, make the trip. You know, down for 2 or 3 days, we'll go to Terry's farm, and we can shoot, and like Terry calls it, beer, barbecue, and bullets. That'd be good stuff.
Hmm.
You know what'd be really cool? I should try to get a hold. I should get a hold of Mike Norris.
I wonder if there's a still.
I should try to get a hold of Mike Norris. See if Mike can get away for a few days. Because I know he's shooting the film now, but it might be done. They might be finished shooting the film by then. I should get a hold of him. Because it'd be kind of cool to have Mike down there. Maybe Mike could bring his film and do a screening of it. That'd be fun, too. Yes, Jim, it is correct.
Well, try to find out if there's any feral hog problem in Missouri. Because if there is,
I don't know.
That sounds like a good opportunity.
I don't know. You know what? If Terry would call in, but he might be swamped right now. I don't know the answer to that question. That's a great question, but I don't know have the answer for it. So, I do not know. But anyways, I wanted to put that out there. Yeah, I think
I'm looking at the Missouri Department of Conservation site, and it says, because they are non-native, destructive and dangerous, feral hogs should be eliminated from Missouri.
Mm-hmm. You know.
Oh, but wanting to kill wild pigs itself, Missouri bans public hog hunting. What?
I'm going to get a hold of Mike
tonight. That was June 29th, 2016.
I'll get a hold of Mike Norris tonight after the show. See if he's available. And you never know. His dad might come with him. I'm not sure. Yeah, I mean, Chuck, he goes back and forth. I mean, he lives out in Los Angeles, but he spends a lot of his time in Texas because in Texas they can film the films. They can make the films they want to make without having the film industry, the studios, telling them what they can and can't make. So I'm just putting it out there. I'm not saying Mike or Chuck will be there. I don't even know if Mike will be there, but what I'll do is I'll ask him, you know, I'll make him aware of it and see if he could, you know, spare a day or two. Because I think it'd be fun to have Mike there. Because I know we'd all like, I'm telling you, Mike has some of the best stories growing up, especially with him and his dad. And by the way, his mom runs the family, not Chuck. So, and that comes from Mike. So, you know, you can imagine the stories he's got growing up in Hollywood. But it'd be fun to have him around there. He's really a good guy. He's a good patriot. And he understands the patriot movement. So with that said, I'll contact him, see if he's available. You know, I don't know if he will be or not, but we'll see. I'll ask him. The worst that he could say is, I really can't. Sorry. No. I've been told no before. Well, I'll be told no again before I'm dead. I'm guarantee you that. So anyway, so that's kind of what we're talking, you know, that's kind of where we're at right now. What do you think? You going to make the trip?
Who, me?
Yes, you.
Or Brian?
You.
It's too early for me to tell. Yeah, too early for me to tell. I got to talk to the boss, the other boss.
No, your only
the other
boss.
CEO in my life.
Your boss. I get it, man. I get it. See, I told my wife, and she says, oh, yeah, that'd be fun. Let's do that. Okay. If she said no, I'd probably go anyways, but no, she wants to come with.
Yeah, I can't hear you. We must have a bad connection.
Why can't you hear me?
I don't know. Just fucking with you.
hold on. You are not a very nice man. You're a very bad man. Very bad. So, anything else? I said tonight. There was just not a lot to comment on. Oh, by the way, what's this? By the way, Brandon says he likes the new slimmer CRN shows. Good for you. You get a gold star, Brandon. You know, yes, they're only an hour,
But I got to tell you guys, we're seeing more listeners and more completions. See, the way Blog Talk Radio has it set up, you've got abandonment, completion, and some other things. Hey, Dana's in the... Dana Kisler is very cool. I have to have... I'm going to have ask her to have Brian call in. Oops. I forgot to say please.
Hey, I think I saw on Contra Radio that Wise Food is offering a 2-for-1 special for Independence Day. Got 3 more days left for that.
Oh, very good. Well, okay. Where is it? Wisefood.com?
Yeah, I'm trying to find it on your site there.
I put it up there. Oh, and for a lot of you don't know, this is a little side note. It's got really nothing to do with it, but it does deal with CRN. I had a blog. I did. It's contrafighter.wordpress.com. I had that blog a few years before I actually got the idea that I could take my blog and turn it into a radio show. Hence, Contra Radio Network came out of that. But a lot of people don't know all that it's there. And if you want to take a look at it, see what I was thinking and talking about at that time, as some of the issues that were being developed and talked about, feel free to visit it. I just thought I'd put it out there. I put it on the group page and the like page. But again, if you want to take a look at it again, it's contrafighter.wordpress.com. You know, so if you're bored one night and you can't sleep, feel free to check in. Where is Brian? We need Brian to call in. I want to make sure Brian knows about this. I mean, granted, he lives in western New Mexico. And I don't know how far, I mean, Texas is a big state. I don't know how long it would take him to come there. Brian said he'll call in just a minute. He's looking for his earpiece. Okay, good. We'll get Brian in. Brian and Dina, in case you didn't know, just had an anniversary, I think, was it yesterday or 2 days ago? I think it was 2 days ago. Happy anniversary, guys. Glad you're here. So that's good. And I actually saw a picture of Brian for the first time. And I got to say, Dana, you could have done better, sweetheart. You could have done better. I know your dad thinks so. That will get him to call in real quick. There it is. 18 years. July 2nd. 18 years. There you go. All right. Mr. I haven't heard from Jim in a while. I'm Jim W. I'm glad he's here. I like Jim. Jim's a good guy. He's also a Patreon. I believe, if I remember right, he's a Patreon.com supporter. Thank you, Jim, so much. And who else have we not heard from? Oh, we've heard from Charles from Nebraska a couple, last week. Haven't heard from him in a while. We heard from Joe Poe during the firearm show. I said, Joe, why do you want to have a firearm show? He goes, oh, I just like him. Okay. I can't argue with that. All right. So that's what we had then. So, and that's why we had the firearm show that Brandon missed, because he couldn't get off. He couldn't get away from work in time. You know, that's all right. No, Jim, thank you for listening, my friend. Thank you, thank you. I appreciate it. Good man. Now, in case you haven't noticed, Illinois is on the verge of financial collapse. Now, we've all heard about the 35%, 32%, is it 32 or 35% tax increase that they passed? Well, now that the governor has vetoed it, apparently the Republicans that decided to cave and go with the tax increase, and some of the other people, some of the other Dems, they can't get a quorum to override the governor's veto. Now, they tried the day before yesterday. They tried yesterday morning, and I think they tried again today. I don't believe they can get a quorum of the House to override the veto. If they cannot get it, the veto is sustained. So either way, I made up my mind. I told my wife a long time ago, what's going to happen is the Republican Party here in Illinois will cave. They'll panic and cave. It is good, Jim. They'll panic and cave, and they'll go with the tax increase and not get anything in return. No spending reforms, nothing. And that's exactly what happened. Now, the good thing is Governor Rauner, who a businessman, a millionaire, a man knows who knows how money works and how to make money, said this can't happen anymore. He vetoed it. And now the Senate decided to override the veto. They did. But the legislature, the House of Representatives, cannot get a quorum, therefore. And some of the Republicans who voted for the tax increase, oh, they can't be found right now, which tells me they're catching a whole hell of a lot of ear. And that's good, because you know what? If those that vote for the tax increase should never even think about running for re-election. In fact, you should just consider yourself dead on arrival, because I guarantee you, your opponent is going to beat you over the head with that unmercifully. They're going to beat you like a baby harp seal, as they should. As a matter of fact, there are some of those Republicans that decided to cave. Their mothers should have used coat hangers on them before they were born. That's right, I said it. I decided, and finally my wife got, she goes, we got to get out of Illinois. I said, no kidding, sweetheart. I've been telling you that for well over a year now. I said, let's take care of what we have to financially and get the hell out of here. So, anyways. All right. My, oh, my. What happened? It's all right. Thank you.
Ooh, sorry.
I'm thinking, what's a little looking here? You know what? The Facebook feed, we had 4 or 5 watchers. Now we're down to 3, and it got really quiet, especially when I said that some of those people, their mothers should have used coat hangers on them.
Ouch.
Either that, or people that are listening to this while driving are probably trying to figure out how to get out of the ditch right now. I'm serious. I've had it with these people. Ah, here we go. We got a caller. Come on, answer it. Hey, Brian.
Hey, boss. How you doing today?
Hey, what's going on with you? I haven't talked to you in a while.
Just been busy dealing with Danner's medical stuff and
okay.
Work and trying to get the property squared away. And right. The Lord gifted us with a 14x76 mobile home, 3-bedroom, 2-bathroom.
Ta-da.
So I couldn't turn that down. That was one of those freebie things that came out of nowhere.
Exactly. You don't turn that down. So, hello. Absolutely.
No, that's up at the property now. So now I had to rearrange everything and run my solar panels. Well, the solar panels stayed in the place, but had to rerun my wiring and stuff. And,
oh, very good.
So, but other than that, things are just putting along.
No.
It's been ridiculously hot down in New Mexico.
It's
still listening to the show every week, though. Sorry. Go ahead.
Brian, I saw that Dina was on the Facebook video feed, and I asked her to have you call in. I don't know if you were listening or not, but
Oh yeah, I was sitting like two inches away from her.
Oh, okay. About Terry having his beer, barbecue, and bullets festivities next month at his farm. Did you hear that?
I did not hear that part of it. We tuned in after that.
Okay.
So I did not catch that.
So August 21st, I'll be going down to Terry's farm. And Rob in Indiana had an idea about two and a half months ago, maybe 3 months, about having a bunch of CRN listeners meet up somewhere. And I thought, well, maybe it's too late this year or whatever. And I was talking to Terry. I said, look, I'm going to be down by your place and whatnot. And Terry says, hey, let's do this. He says, I'll set up a shooting range. We could call it beer, barbecue, and bullets. And we could just have a bunch of, just sit around and do that. And I said, well, you know, some of the listeners had talked about getting like a CRN convention, have all the listeners meet somewhere and just, you know, do what we do. And he liked,
he's in Missouri, right?
Right, southeast Missouri.
Right smack dab in the middle of the country.
Right, southeast Missouri. Lebanon, Missouri, to be exact. So I thought, you know, I said, Brian needs to know this because I thought Brian would have a ball with this. You know. So, but anyways, I wanted to let you know, my man. That's why I asked.
Yeah, that sounds, I'll have to see what I can schedule there.
Well, yeah.
I've got a friend coming in from England on the 14th, but I'm not sure how long he's going to be here, so I have to play that one by ear.
Well, okay. I just wanted you to know about it. And I'll pull.
On a side note?
Yeah, go ahead.
Let me just throw something out there real quick.
Go ahead, fire away.
For all of those people who are residing, this is a national public service announcement.
Ah.
For all those individuals residing in the tyranny state of Illinois, you can still buy 20 acres of land in New Mexico for $14,000 cash.
There you go.
With lots of pine trees and up in the mountains.
Yay!
There you go. That's it. Let me tell you, a lot of people here are pissed off to no end. Jim W. is one of them, I guarantee it. And I want you to know something. A lot of people said, that's it. We want out. We're leaving. Screw you. And
good
your
luck.
Tax increase.
You're talking about the income tax hike?
Yeah. A lot of people are pissed about
it.
Yeah,
well, you know what? As long as you work in Illinois, you're stuck with that. So if you even move to Kenosha or to somewhere in Wisconsin,
right,
won't make a difference because that's been deducted directly off your paycheck. Now, if it was a property tax hike,
well, you know what?
Then I can see where moving to Kenosha or to some other state would be a viable plan.
And you're absolutely right, except for one thing. Those morons decided to cross the aisle, vote for the tax increase, and they got nothing for it. It was a separate issue, a separate vote, only on the tax increase. They didn't get anything for it. No spending reforms, no property tax freeze, and I guarantee you those idiots. You know, and the Illinois Republican Party sits there and wonders why they lose election after election after election here.
Well, we got 11 or 12 feckless Republicans in the state legislature that pretty much didn't even negotiate hard enough. They just caved in and just let them let the left.
Of course
them
they
away.
Did. Well, they will. It's ridiculous, absolutely ridiculous. So for those Republicans that caved, don't bother running for re-election. Don't bother. Going to happen.
You know, they could raise my property taxes 30% down here.
Yeah.
And I still wouldn't break $60 for 10 acres.
It never ends in Illinois. Illinois, people who live in Illinois already pay the highest taxes in the country. I didn't know that was real. It was in the Chicago Tribune today.
I'm not sure how they rate, though, but New York and California pretty much are amongst the top five as well, and so is Missouri, come to think of it.
I was going to say, because California's ridiculous.
Minnesota.
I know when I was self-employed, if I had moved to California, I would have been in like the 57% with state, federal, local, county, city, 57% tax bracket. That's just ridiculous.
I got to go puke. Oh, good God. That is ridiculous.
It might be, you know what, I'll tell you what, John. I think for you and you know, your family, since you're retired and everything.
Yeah.
Moving out might be a viable thing for you just to let your pension, last a little longer someplace with a lower cost of living, to be honest.
No, you're right. I talked to some of my ex-partners. And we've all come to the same agreement. We're all getting out. We're done. Sorry. Bye.
Go to Missouri.
You know what? It's funny. That's what Terry said. You know, Terry said, hey, he said, you should come to Missouri and check out what we got. It's like, yeah, but Missouri gets a lot of winter. I hate winter. I'm tired of this.
Southeast Oklahoma's not too bad.
I want to go farther south than that. I want to go somewhere.
I can hook you up with a realtor in New Mexico.
Does it snow there?
Real good guy. Mike Candelaria.
Well,
you know, up at the
on.
Mountains, up
hold
where on. Our property's at.
Does well, sorry, go to southern Missouri, like southwest, I'm sorry, southeast of Mark Twain National Forest. That way you're going to be close to the Kentucky and the Tennessee borders. And you were thinking about going there anyways because it has a more of a growing season. Or a
no,
climate
no,
for growing
right.
crops and food and so on and so forth. So,
no, you're right.
You know, that's something to consider.
You know,
where my property is at up in the mountains mm-hmm. is in western, I'm literally 28 miles from Arizona. But I'm in north, kind of northwest New Mexico.
Oh, okay.
So last winter we had a really, 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 really snowy winter. In that they had 8 snowstorms over the course of the winter. Of which 4 of them were over 8 inches. Now, mind you, it was 50 degrees the next day, so it all melted off. And actually, one time, there was almost 6 inches of snow, 5.5 inches of snow on the ground. We left and drove to town. We came back, and it was all gone. An hour and a half later, it had all melted.
You see, that's,
so,
that's what
it's,
I want.
You know, but it,
I want it so if it snows.
I'm sorry, what?
I want to be that one, it never snows there, or two, if it does, it goes away right away. I'm tired.
Right, yeah, and that's why, that's one of the reasons. Well, that, and we're at a high enough altitude up there that, like, last year, they had 2 days that was over 100 degrees, and I think they had about 12 or 13 days over 90. So, it's not like the rest of New Mexico, where one envisions a desert. It's actually pine-covered and relatively mild. Of course, it's 7,300 feet in elevation, so that's why.
No, I get it. Okay.
And I can get 3 harvests over the course of the year. So, you know, that's a bonus, too.
Okay, thanks, Brian, for making us all feel better. You can all kiss our collective ass. Thank you. I got 3 harvests.
I keep telling you, you need to come down here and look at property. The price is ridiculously cheap. And, you know...
What's your property
it's like,
tax?
It's got everything that...
What's your property tax on your property? How much are you paying on property tax?
I pay $46 a year. And when I first called, they didn't actually send us a bill. So I had my wife call. And I was like, you'll find out how much it is because, you know, we haven't gotten a bill yet. And so she calls them, and the lady's like, $46. She's like, $46? And he's like, oh, but we can break that up into 2 payments if you need us to.
Oh, my. Yeah, but you also live off the grid, so there are literally no utilities or anything where you're at, right?
Right, yep. Yeah, I have solar. The well hasn't gone in yet. We're using rainwater collection, and I do get some water. I do pay for some water every now and then. But most of it's rainwater and solar and then septic tank. So once the well goes in, which will be end of next year, at that point I'll be 100% off grid.
Jim W. wants to know, how deep is your well?
The property that is just to the west of me, the guy that owns that.
No, hold on.
He drilled
hold
a well
on.
Last
Brian,
year.
Brian, don't, Brian, yeah. Brian, don't answer that. Don't answer that. You tell Jim, if he wants to have the answer to that question, he's going to have to buy Brian a beer. Get him sufficiently inebriated, and then be on a first name basis. Otherwise, he doesn't answer that question on the first date.
You are so wrong, dude. You are so wrong. I don't even know where to begin with.
The property that's just to the west of me. They just drilled a well. They hit water at 375 feet and went to 425. And the property that's to the east of me. They drilled a well about a year and a half ago,
uh-huh.
And they're up on a hill, so they hit water at 420 and went to 480.
Okay.
So
wow.
Anywhere from about 375 to 420.
Wow. Okay. There you have it. All right, guys.
Feet?
We are. I got.
Feet. Yes.
I got a few more minutes.
Wow.
I got like 3 minutes left. So, anyways. Oh.
Also. Just to throw it out there that because I live near a Native American reservation,
yeah.
The aquifer is actually owned by the Native Americans. So they put limitations on how much water we can actually extract out of the ground.
Really?
They limit us. Yeah, they limit us at 160,000 gallons per quarter.
That's a lot of water.
So, that is. When the guy told me that there was limitations, I was like, "Uh-oh, here we go."
Yeah.
And then he told me how much, and I'm like, "When does that ever become an issue?" And he's like, "Well, I suppose if you had a ranch, you were, you know, farming."
Okay.
And I'm like, "There's no one farms up there. We're on top of a mountain."
Oh, yeah, irrigation. That's why. Yeah. So you know what? To be on the safe side, you might want to get a little bit more rainwater collectors up there just to supplement what you got. You know what I mean? But
He knows that.
You're not going to use the well water for any irrigation, the Walker for irrigation anytime soon, are you?
Well, at 160,000 gallons per quarter, that's over 500,000 gallons per year.
Yeah, I was just gonna say.
I honestly don't think on my 10-acre lot that I could probably irrigate the entire thing year-round nonstop and not hit that.
Wow.
Hmm.
There you go. New Mexico. Get a hold of Brian if you don't know his address. His email address, get a hold of me at ContraRadio@live.com. ContraRadio@live.com. Address it to Brian. I will forward it. Brian will get back to you. He's really good about doing that. Happy anniversary, buddy.
Thank you, sir.
Oh, yes. All right, and hopefully you can make it over to Terry's farm next month. I think we'll have a good time if we get enough people there. So, yes.
Yeah, I'll have to see what I can do about that. And as far as, like, the land goes, I know of at least 3 land dealers in New Mexico and 1 realtor.
Okay.
All of them are good people. All of them have really good prices. And a good portion of the land is financeable through owner financing if,
okay,
you know, there's credit issues or anything like that. So down here, they just try to sell the land. They're so desperate to sell land down here because nobody wants to move to New Mexico. I don't understand why, because, you know, we're like number 3 from the bottom of the list for poorest states probably, but.
Don't matter.
You know.
Well, yeah, because they're only charging $46 for. All right.
Right. Well, that's probably why we're so poor.
Yeah, it could be. But you know what? They're not taxing their people to death, and they get a gold star for that. All right, then. They'll do it for the Roundtable Report this week. Thank you for everybody that joined us on the Facebook Live video. To Jim and Brandon and others. And Cyber Patriot, thanks for listening. And, of course, my good friend Chuck for calling in and helping out tonight. Always enjoy having him here. It's always good. And for Brian in New Mexico for calling in and checking with us. We like to hear from him on occasion. With that said, I will be back on Sunday night. We got Dawn's show, 9 p.m. 9 p.m. Friday night. And right now, Julie is traveling cross country after getting lost in Idaho. She's back on track. She's still moving cross-country. I don't know if she'll have a show Saturday night or not, but either way, Dawn and I will be here this weekend. All right. From my prepper and patriot friends, I say to you this. Be safe. Be alert. And be vigilant. John Jefferson of the Contra Radio Network is thanking Chuck and Brian for joining us tonight.
90 seconds.
And I will see you Sunday night. Thank you for sharing some of your time with me tonight. I truly appreciate and humbled by it. I'm John Just with the Contra Radio Network saying good night and thank you.
Thank you for using Blog Talk Radio.